I'm Kelby Johnson. I'm part of the Seattle Wonderman Network. And before I introduce the inventor from Intellectual Ventures Lab, show of hands, how many of you out there in the audience are hackers, self-proclaimed hackers? Yeah, yeah. How many of you self-proclaimed hackers feel that you have superpowers? Nice. Few. Well, Pablos is going to come up here and educate you all on the superpowers you have and how to activate them to create awesome stuff and innovations. Hats off to you, Pablos.
Hey, thanks.
Okay. Stop, I haven't done anything yet. Okay, so these guys somehow screwed up and gave me an entire hour, so we have a lot of time to play. I've been doing like Ignite talks, you know, in like 5 minutes, so I can talk really fast, but since we have time, I'm gonna just show you all kinds of cool shit. So this is a bit about hackers. So this is a hotel room, maybe like the one you're staying in, not a very exciting place to hang out. But what's interesting is if you're bored, that TV is not like the TV in your house. That TV is a node on a network. It's connected to all the other TVs in the hotel. So if you plug in a little USB infrared transceiver into your computer, you can send codes to that TV that it's not expecting. Codes that the remote in the room can't send. So you can watch movies for free, which I know is not all that exciting because you have Netflix and stuff now. Can play games for free, big deal. But you can not only do that for your TV in your hotel room, you can do it for everybody else's TV in the hotel. So you can decide who's watching Disney or porn tonight. If there's online checkout, you can watch people put in their credit card numbers. If there's a keyboard hooked up so they can surf the web, then you can watch them surf the web. People do all kinds of retarded stuff on their hotel TVs. I mean, they don't seem secure to you, right? I like this, funds transfer. you probably can't see this crappy slide. $25 million funds transfer. Yeah, and then, you know, what? This is literally just pictures we took of hotel TVs. It turns out there's like four different companies who make the systems for doing hotel TV networks, and they all work exactly the same way. So this is a project I worked on with a buddy of mine named Eric Johansson, another notorious computer hacker, where we were trying to show what's wrong with the security in Wi-Fi networks, and nobody was paying any attention to us, and then we got excited about building a robot. So we built this robot called the HackerBot, and the HackerBot can drive around and find Wi-Fi users, drive up to them, and show them their passwords on the screen. Which, exactly, we thought sounded like a lot of fun. You could do the same thing with a laptop, but it's a lot less exciting. Everybody liked the HackerBot, so it got a lot of airtime. Another project I did here in Seattle with Ben Laurie, we were trying to show the sort of unintended side effects of some of these technologies. And one of them, in particular, we were working on at the time was Bluetooth. So this is a conference that was here in Seattle, actually, called Computers, Freedom, and Privacy. So the conference where people go talk about these things. So I put a computer in each room of the conference, just like this, and it would just log Bluetooth traffic as people came in and out of the door. So I would know who was in what session and how long. This is the map I made for Kim Cameron, the chief privacy architect at Microsoft. So unbeknownst to him, I know he got bored, went downstairs, took a leak, came back up, hung out in the lobby. I can correlate this to the maps for everybody else at the conference and see who hangs out with who. So version two of this, I figure, which we haven't done yet, I should do the same thing out in front of, like, let's say, the cathedral and Congress and the XXX store, and we'll just see who makes that route. but you could do the same kind of thing with the radios and for GSM, with the RFIDs and passports and credit cards and things. I mean, this is just a design flaw or feature, depending on how you look at it, of Bluetooth, because your phone is just saying, "Hey, I'm here, and my name is Kim Cameron." You know, so fun things you can discover. This is an old buddy of ours named Sammy, also a famous computer hacker. Famous because Sammy was trying to meet chicks on MySpace. And it wasn't going very well, because I don't know if you guys remember MySpace. Anybody here ever used MySpace? It's kind of like Facebook for your grandparents. Yeah. So MySpace is just like Facebook. If I look at your page and you don't have any friends, you don't seem very cool. Sammy didn't have any friends, so he didn't seem very cool. So he figured out that he could write a little bit of JavaScript to put in his profile so that whenever anybody looked at his page, it would just automatically add them as Sammy's friend. So it would skip the whole "is Sammy really your friend" protocol, right? And then it would change your page to say that Sammy is my hero. So Sammy's looking a little cooler, but he did one other thing. He made it so that that code would copy itself to your page. So whenever anybody looked at your page, it would add them as Sammy's friend too. So in under 24 hours, Sammy had over 1 million friends on MySpace. It was actually one of the fastest worms on the internet ever, and they had to shut down MySpace after that. But Sammy had to serve 3 years probation. He wasn't allowed to use a computer. So now he's back. So Sammy figured out recently, it cracks me up. Anybody use these map programs on your phone or computer? They're getting popular. It's what people do now instead of MySpace. He figured out that for Google Maps, you know, the way that Google knows what the traffic looks like is based on phones reporting what's going on, right? Your Android phones in particular are saying, you know, how fast you're moving and what street you're on, and letting Google know so that they can update the traffic, which is pretty cool. But Sammy figured out he could just spoof those messages to Google. So when he's driving someplace, Sammy can make all the roads in front of him where he's driving turn black so people get out of his way. This is another buddy of ours, Christopher Abad, another deranged hacker trying to meet chicks on the internet, having spotty results. So what Abad did is he took a open source spam filter called Spam Assassin. Normally the way these things work is you train them. You feed it some legitimate email, you feed it some spam. It uses artificial intelligence to figure out the difference on incoming messages, right? So Abad just took a spam filter and trained it on profiles of girls he had dated and liked as legitimate email, profiles of girls he dated and did not like as spam, and then just runs it against every profile on the internet and outspits girls he might like to date. I think that's genius. I mean, why do you have Match.com if you can have spam dating? You know, there ought to be, you know, a few startups here working on this. So the beauty of this, the point before I fall off the edge of the stage here with excitement, is these guys think differently than you do. Hopefully not all of you. But they think differently than most people. And the reason is that their brains are just wired up screwy. And sometimes you get amazing results. These aren't guys who are reading the directions and following them. They're like violating the warranty before they got something out of the box. You know, if you give one of these guys a new gadget, it's a much different experience than if you give it to your mom, right? If you give whatever new gadget you got to your mom, she's going to ask, well, what does this do? You explain. It's a phone, Mom. That's why it says iPhone. You know? Oh, I got it. Okay. Let me see the directions. But if you give a new anything to Abad or Sammy, the question is completely different. The question is, what can I make this do? Right? And they're going to take all the screws out, flip it over, break it into a lot of little pieces, and then figure out what can we build from the rubble, right? And that discovery process of figuring out what's possible is crucial. That's fundamental to invention, fundamental to innovation. You can't skip that part or you don't get any new technologies, right? We have to figure out what's possible. And people who are reading the directions aren't necessarily optimized for figuring out what's possible. These guys will make no assumptions about what a spam filter is good for, right? So the point of that is to say that, like, you know, when you work in technology, I mean, I assume almost everybody here is at least peripherally working in technology. The point of that is that we get to do that every day. My job as an inventor is the bleeding edge of that. I take every new chip, every new sensor, every new scientific discovery that I can find out about every day, and that is a new superpower that I get to strap on and try out for the day and figure out, can I apply this to any problem humans have? Does this change the way we've done something? Right? That's why technology is exciting. That's why it's always new, by definition. That's why it never ends, because we get those discoveries every day about what's possible. And so one of the things you might want to try and do is find these people in your company, get them out of the computer security department, because that's a lost cause, and get them back into product development or discovery, you know, get them building stuff. Anyway, you guys use keys like this for your cars? Bloop. No? I have one. They're cool. Remote controls for your doors. So kids these days have figured out they can go driving through a Walmart parking lot and click open, 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 bloop. Eventually, you find another, you know, Jetta or Focus or whatever that looks like yours, different color. But it has the same key code inside, which is kind of bizarre because giant random numbers are essentially free. You could have every car have a different key code, but somehow the auto manufacturers missed that point, right? It's a fundamental computer security thing. And what's exciting about this is that right out from under them, these formerly car companies became PC on wheels companies, right? When I was a kid, there were no computers in a car, and I would try to tell people how exciting it would be to have a computer in your car, and I was categorically crazy. Now you have about 70 computers in your car, and it's normal. And what's interesting about that is we have a lot of experience with computers, and we know what the problems are because we've lived through them, right? For one brand of this key, for one manufacturer, we figured out how to manipulate the key so that it will open any car from that manufacturer. So, like, I can just drive by the dealership and go bloop, and I get all of the cars at once. That's kind of exciting. Superpower, right? but that doesn't matter. The point is that there's no system update in your car, with the possible exception of, like, a Tesla that probably needs system updates. But your car doesn't have system update. You're driving the last car that you will ever have that doesn't have system update. Your phone has system update. It's the first phone you've ever had that had system update, right? Everything before it had riddled with computer security problems and no plan. These guys have no plan for fixing these locks. What are they gonna do, roll them all into the dealership and swap out a part like they always do? That's not, that's a historical mindset about being in the auto business. But what's cool about this is it makes, I don't need those things. It makes you prescient about every other industry, right? Because now there's a PC in your car. What's this thing? A power supply and some computer chips. That's what's inside, right? Power supply, computer chips. What's in your pocket? Power supply, computer chips. There's a Tesla. Power supply, computer chips, basically. Right? All this, every business has figured out that a way to accelerate what they do, to try and jump on the Moore's Law bandwagon, to add features and add capabilities and all these things, make a futuristic product, well, we add computer chips. So since you've been using computers for a long time and know what some of the problems are, you can guess what's going to happen in almost every other industry. That's a way that I kind of cheat as an inventor. I just look around and say, well, where haven't computers gone yet? What would it be like if they went there, right? This is probably the last mechanical thing in your life that has no computer chips. Anybody use these locks? This is a Schlage lock. It's on about half of the front doors in America, including mine. Anybody here ever try to pick locks with tools like this? Nice. Well, this guy can tell you that it's tedious, pain in the ass, and if you don't have OCD to sit there and finick with it for hours, you're not going to get the job done. You can do it in 10 seconds now, but not your first time. How many hours did it take you to learn to pick locks? A lot. There you go. Okay. We don't have a lot of hours because we have ADD. So here's how we're going to do it. I'm going to teach you the easy way. This is a Schlage lock, although that doesn't really matter. This is a key that is a Schlage key, so it fits in there, but it's not cut properly. It won't open the lock, but I've modified the key a little bit. So now I'm just going to smack that thing. Oh. Well, shit. This works better if you're not demoing. Hold on. This is the worst demo ever. I need some Red Bull. This stuff does not have the same kick. All right, hold on, we'll try again. Oh, shit. I was about to make a point about, oh, there we go. That was the worst lock picking experience I've ever had. So we just picked a lock. Was that easier than the way you learned? Bump keys are awesome. So this is called bump key. There's videos on YouTube of 11-year-old girls showing you how to learn this technique, okay? That's pretty much how I learned. Just look up bump key. Now, since I'm a nut, I bought a key machine and I made bump keys for all the other kinds of locks in America. And this technique will work on any of them, right? And it's much easier to learn than tools like that. But what's interesting is that that really is probably the last thing that you use every day, maybe your toaster that doesn't have a computer chip. I actually installed one of these electronic locks on my front door, so now I have, we're gonna unlock my front door. Beep. I'll freak out my dog. Every time he hears it go, he thinks I'm home. Now I can lock it up. So this is how your lock will be next year, right? Because it's a pain in the ass to carry this stuff around and scratch up your iPhone screen, so you're just gonna replace it, right? So, I don't know what point I was making, I'm moving on. So anybody use these USB thumb drives? You should have got one in your conference bag. Okay, that's not like the ones you had before. I put those there. And when you put it in your computer, magically and invisibly, it's gonna send me a little backup of your My Documents folder, your browser history and cookies, the registry, the password database. So if you ever lose that stuff, just come see me. Okay? You won't even see anything happening. You can still use it to print Word documents and stuff. No, I'm teasing. I didn't actually do that. But I could have. That would be fun. This one works that way. It's kind of an interesting thing, right? Because you have no idea all the different ways in which you're vulnerable. I'm not actually interested in talking about computer security because we all know that's a has-been topic. But you should know, like right now, this is an interesting thing. We used to like attack servers and try and steal shit from servers, and now the servers have been more secured and that's kind of a pain. It turns out there's no point going after the server because the clients are so insecure. So right now, you're running, probably the three biggest attack vectors in the world are Adobe Flash, Adobe PDF Reader, and Java, because they're all activated from your browser. So I can load malicious code into a web page that will kick off the executables that read those things or execute those things. They're all fundamentally little executable Turing machines that can load malware. And then those things take over your computer. And what's fascinating is like there's this whole, it's almost like we planned it. There's this whole network of ad distribution that puts flash ads on websites. So all I gotta do is load up an ad with malware, send it out to the ad network, and they'll send it out to thousands of computers. I don't even need my own website. And I can take over thousands of computers. That's how it works. And all this stuff is completely automated thanks to Ukrainian hackers who make little toolkits that you can rent or buy. Like, there's, you should just go Google for like Crime Pack. That's an easy one. You can just buy a copy of Crime Pack and it'll give you a little GUI. It says, how many computers do you want to own today? 10,000, great. Do you want to own them using PDF or Flash or Java? I'll take Java and PDF and Flash, what the hell? And then it'll tell you, what do you want to do with them? Collect credit card numbers or bank accounts or PayPal addresses or what? Like you get, it's all menu driven. You don't even need to learn how to hack, right? Right now, your computer has been taken over by one of these things. That's how common this shit is. And you're lucky because there are so many computers that are taken over that the statistical odds of anybody getting around to taking advantage of your personal information are pretty low. Pretty cool, huh? Feel better? I don't know why I'm even talking about that. Okay, anybody use credit cards like this? These new ones, I got a new one in the mail a few years ago that said it was my new secure credit card, which I got really excited about because I don't usually get stuff in the mail that says it's secure. And I thought, you know, that was kind of interesting because it has this computer chip in it, just like everything else, right? And it's supposed to be secure because it has a computer chip. And since I know a little bit about these things, I thought, yeah, well, you know, it's an RFID chip. It's probably got my credit card info encrypted on there. And, you know, for fun, maybe we should try and decrypt it. And then we could steal some credit card numbers on the weekends for fun. So I bought a bunch of stuff on eBay for reading RFIDs, RFID readers. One of the things I got was this reader here from eBay for $8. It's just like the one at Starbucks. Anybody have one of these newfangled credit cards with a RFID in it? Yeah? Come on up. hold on a sec. I gotta switch to Python for this part. You guys all use Python for your presentations? Python. Boom. you're gonna love this. Okay, so you gotta run we had to write like the lamest possible code. We call it pwn pass. Okay. Oh shit, it didn't work. What happened here? Oh shit. Okay, hold on. All right, we're gonna debug in real time. Sudo. Oh no, that's not what I want. Oh shit, okay, hold on, this is not the usual demo program. Oh, there it is, 2014, jeez, okay, wow. Where is it, Python, oh, whoops, wrong thing. Okay, hold on, man, sorry to make you wait for me to steal your credit card. Okay. Oops. Oh, that's not where I want, okay, hold on. See why they gave me an hour? Okay. Okay, remember that 2014. This is what hacking actually looks like. You guys are getting the inside view. Okay, Python. this is why I don't do demos anymore. Okay, feed me Seymour. All right, where's your credit card? All right, leave it right there. Oh, it's a debit card?
Yes.
This is not a good idea. No, okay, hold on a minute. This is not going to work. All right, you're excused, because that's actually, this is the European kind. It's a contact card, so it doesn't work with RFID. You have to actually touch the contacts to read that. That's much more secure. Who's my next victim? Any volunteers? This is really going to be exciting if you get to see it work. All right. Anybody want to peer pressure somebody into coming? You got a card?
How do we know if we have? I don't know.
All right, let's find out. Come here. We got lots of time, so we're just going to. I've already wasted a bunch of time fixing my code on stage.
It's not going to show what I've been buying, right?
Nope, I'm not going to show what you've been buying. That's a very, okay, so this is also, so that one where you can see the contact,
that's not one.
That's the cool kind. Yeah, you got the cool kind from Europe. It's European style.
Yeah.
This is the problem with, now you see computer hacking is,
same thing.
Yeah, geez, what the hell? Okay, we'll steal my own damn credit card. All right, here's how it works. Beep, did you hear the beep? Okay, that means a hacker is stealing your credit card number. Okay, so we'll talk about hacking in a minute. Name, valued customer. So we bitched about this on television a bunch, and so American Express, in this case, made it more secure by taking my name off the RFID and it reissuing my card. So now it doesn't show my name anymore, it shows valued customer. But that's my Amex, and you've got, oh shit, it's expired, so you can't use my card number. Yeah, anyway, the point is, there's no like actual crypto. How does this seem more secure to you? The old-fashioned ones, and like the ones people did bring up on stage, I actually have to get out of your wallet in order to steal your credit card number, right? This fancy new one, I can just read it through your pocket. So I just hang out at Starbucks with my reader and in the line, and you know, every time it beeps, I cough. Beep. Oh, yeah, that works great. So if you need any credit card numbers, come see me after that. Okay, where's my? We'll go back to the conventional way of doing presentations. Okay, there is a point though I was going to make, which is, oh yeah. Well, 2 points. One is hacking is totally error prone. I have no QA department. That's why these demos fail all the time. and I think what's actually happened and why there aren't a lot of these cards is that they stopped shipping them. It's not clear to me that the credit card companies are sending these out so much anymore. So it's possible that bitching about it on the national news has turned around their perspective on it. But we don't know. They never gave us any credit. So the other thing is, and you should learn this, the credit card industry does not have a security problem at all. What they have is what you call a risk management problem. And the risk is managed. So what happens if I steal your credit card number and I go to victoriassecret.com and buy some stuff and have it shipped to my neighbor? And I check his mail while he's at work. That's how we do it. And then you get your statement. You call American Express or whatever and say, or call your bank and say, you know, I didn't buy anything from Victoria's Secret. Kind of wish I had. So give me my money back. And they're like, no problem, Mr. Whatever. That was fraud. You get your money back. And then they call Victoria's Secret's bank and say, that was fraud. Give us the money back. And they have to. And so Victoria's Secret's bank calls Victoria's Secret and says, hey, that was fraud, give us the money back. And give us the transaction fee back. And give us a $25 to $35 chargeback fee, which a merchant has to pay for every fraudulent transaction. So Victoria's Secret lost all that, the money they got paid, they lost the transaction fee, they lost the chargeback fee, and the products they sent to my neighbor, right? Nobody else lost anything. The merchant bears all the risk, and that means it's managed. So that's okay. You should look for opportunities in your business to take your security problems and class them as risk management problems, and then manage the risk, and you're done. You can go wakeboarding or whatever it is you're into. Oh, that's my subliminal marketing campaign. You can ignore that one. Okay, so this is a protocol diagram for SSL, which is the encryption system in your web browser that encrypts your credit card numbers when you send them to Victoria's Secret, right? And that's really boring, but what's interesting to hackers is that we'll attack every point in this protocol. What happens if I send a date from the future? What happens if I send two responses instead of one? What happens if I send a zero instead of a one? Well, the whole thing might come crashing down. If it breaks, that gets me really excited. Because if it breaks in some way, then maybe I can get it to break in some other way. Like a way that gives me your credit card number or password or something, right? This is what hacking is all about. Just trying to screw with the world and see what falls in our lap. This is Anopheles defensi. Oh, I skipped that. She's a female mosquito carrying malaria in Africa. She kills about 1 million people a year. Half of them are kids under 5. We don't understand a lot about mosquitoes. It turns out, like, that's not Bernoulli effect. We don't even know why they can fly. They're like swimming in air or something. And this is a protocol diagram for malaria. And it spends part of its life cycle in a human, part of its life cycle in the mosquito. It's very complicated. We don't understand everything about how this works. We're trying to figure it out. But what I do in the lab where I work is hire hackers to attack every point in that protocol, right? I need to discover how to interrupt the life of a mosquito, interrupt the life of malaria, so that we can save those lives. And I need minds that can figure it out, because there are no directions. It has not been figured out before. We don't have the answer. We don't know what to do. Actually, it got figured out a little bit. In America, we got rid of malaria. And this is how we did it. We sprayed chemicals that kill everything, and most of the good stuff comes back. And then we teach kids to sing. This is like a real ad from like the 30s. DDT is good for me. DDT is not good for you. We eventually kind of figured that out, and it became politically unpopular to spray chemicals, so we gave up before we got rid of malaria in Africa. And so we have to invent new weapons for the arsenal to go after malaria. So part of how we're doing that is I run a 5,000-core computational cluster in the lab, and we do computational modeling work to try and see what happens with the spread of diseases, and malaria in particular. So this is what we call a Monte Carlo simulation. So we literally collect data on everything we can: rainfall, travel of humans, climate, clinical cases of malaria, everything that we know about malaria. And that goes into a giant computer model where we can see what happens and we can simulate what will happen in the future. So this is an example. This is just Madagascar, which is kind of a handy test case for us. This is malaria over the course of the year in Madagascar. Now, if you go to Madagascar, go to the middle, because you can see that's the part where malaria never goes. And incidentally, it's where most of the people still do live. So in the rainy season, you can see it spreads almost everywhere. And then in the dry season, it goes away almost completely. But because we have this model, we can test our interventions thousands of times in software before we ever do it in the real world. That's an amazing thing that, you know, historically was computationally infeasible, right? A Monte Carlo simulation works like kind of like a Photoshop filter, you know? Every time you run the filter, it has to compute what effect this color is going to have on all the neighboring pixels, and then those are going to have some effect on the ones around them. It's like I'm doing that, but instead of color, I'm using data about the transmission of disease. Very computationally intensive. If you remember running Photoshop filters, on your PowerBook, then it took a while, and you know, that's probably when you learned to drink coffee and take coffee breaks, right? Now your computers are so damn fast, you can just click try it and keep trying stuff, and like computationally, it's like done. Well, that's what we're doing with other types of modeling. And all this work is going on at the Intellectual Ventures Lab. So it's kind of a weird place. This is our machine shop where we can prototype stuff. Basically, we just bought one of every tool in the world, hired one of every kind of scientist, and then we try to invent for some of the world's biggest problems. This is our warehouse, so we just ran out of space, and we just bought one of every tool and stuck it in the warehouse. So there's literally everything there, from scanning electron microscopes to ICBMs. And I can have any of those in the lab, you know, this afternoon if I need it. And that's a way of cheating for us to be faster, so we can try our inventions and see how they work. I got, you know, 8,000 tools there. One of the things we got carried away with was the science of cooking. The way people cook is like cavemen, you know. Oh, that looks yummy. Blast some heat on it and shove it in my mouth. It's not very informed about what's going on a molecular level. So we've been trying to come up with ways of explaining to chefs what's actually going on behind the scenes. One of the things we did is we started cutting kitchen tools in half in our machine shop, and then we could take these cross-sectional photos illustrating cooking processes. This is our cheeseburger, which we claim is the world's best cheeseburger. It takes 30 hours to prepare, although you get fries made using an ultrasonic cavitator, and you need a tank of liquid nitrogen to make this cheeseburger, but it's really good. Anyway, I don't know, there's no point to this. We got carried away, and we built this 2,400-page cookbook on the science of cooking. You need like a forklift to install it in your kitchen. The book weighs 50 pounds and has like 4.5 pounds of ink in each copy. But if you want to learn about the science of cooking, this is the way to do it. So back to mosquitoes. I don't know what I'm doing. You just get a little of everything here. One of our ideas was, hey, let's go after those mosquitoes and shoot them down with laser beams, which seemed like a lot of fun to us. So we started by trying to track them. And it turns out we could track them. And this is live mosquitoes, and we track them using like machine vision off of a video camera. And then we aim a laser at them, and we use the laser to sample their wing beat frequency. And then we can shoot them down with a lethal laser. This is fun stuff. That, you know, mosquito isn't coming back. Here we lit her up, vaporized her wing. She's dead. It's okay, you can laugh. Mosquitoes, nobody's coming to the rescue of mosquitoes. Not even PETA cares if you laugh. It's okay. Here we like vaporize entire mosquito. Yeah, nobody likes them. So the point is, we built this system that can like find mosquitoes, track them, and shoot them down with laser beams. And the idea is you put it on a fence post every 100 meters or so around a building or a village or something, and shoot down mosquitoes as they fly towards humans at dusk. Eventually we realized, oh, you could protect crops this way too, with a organic photonic pesticide, which I thought was kind of fun. Better than spraying chemicals, right? What's going on here? Well, again, we're using Moore's law. We're computing the value of the life of every individual bug before we shoot it down. Again, unprecedented amount of computation that we're applying. But what's in this thing? You know, the chip from like a GPU for doing motion detection algorithms, laser galvo like you'd find a laser printer for steering a laser, lasers like what you'd find in a Blu-ray burner, and then the CMOS sensor from a video camera. You know, all that stuff is solid-state electronics. It gets cheaper every year on an exponential curve. Yeah, I spent thousands of dollars on lab gear from eBay to build the first one, but in a few years, we'll ship it to Africa. So this is what we call a cubic mile of oil. And it's just a way of visualizing a problem, which is a really important part of what we're all trying to do. Every one of you is in some way trying to work on some problem, solve some problem for customers or yourself. But it's really good to kick back a bit, do some arithmetic, and imagine, how big is this problem? Try and understand it in that way. I get it wrong all the time because I love inventing new stuff. So I'll just go and invent some crazy idea for something when I don't understand the problem. And I get a lot of useless stuff that way. fortunately, I have time to do that. In this case, one of the problems we're going after is oil. So let's understand. A cubic mile of oil is how much energy we used globally in the year 2000. So that's equivalent to, here's some other numbers for you, but you can see it's 5 Eiffel Towers stacked up, makes a mile. Today, so in 13 years later, we use 3.5 cubic miles of oil a year, right? So these are very conservative estimates, but we'll just go with them. So by 2035, so another 20 years, we need an additional 1.8 cubic miles of oil. And this takes into account all of the, you know, efficiency and reduction policies that the planet has put in place, you know, with governments saying we're going to reduce energy consumption, even though they never do. Assuming they worked, we'll just give them the benefit of the doubt. If they work really well, we only need another 1.4 cubic miles in the next 20 years. So this is as good as it can get if everybody gets what they're dreaming of. By 2050, you know, we're going to run out. Well, we imagine running out of oil and gas, coal and oil. So we're going to need another 4 to 5 cubic miles of oil per year to replace the stuff that we run out of. Maybe we won't run out. Maybe we'll discover something new. But you know, this is just to help you visualize, even if I'm wrong. So we figured, let's look at what other ways can we get some energy, right? Examples like solar and wind, you know, we're all very excited about improving those things. Well, here's an example. 1 cubic mile of oil can be eliminated if we cover all the flyover states with windmills, the biggest, baddest windmills we've got, right? All those states in the middle. So what happens after we succeed at covering all of those entire states with windmills? Well, then we do the next set of states over there, because, you know, we don't, you know, Nevada, New Mexico, who cares? Put windmills there, Texas. You know. But you can see, at some point, we're going to run out of places to put windmills. So this stuff is pretty interesting. That can, the size of a Coors Light, contains as much energy as 120,000 barrels of oil. This, you know, uranium this big, well, maybe twice that big, or $12 million of gas. If you just pop a, you know, pump into your Prius and let the pump go until the bill is $12 million, like that's how much energy you get out of one little can of uranium. So what we do today is we dig uranium out of the ground. It goes through this complicated enrichment process to make it fissionable, because the stuff we get out of the ground is actually decayed and you can't sustain a nuclear fission reaction with it. So we enrich it. And what happens is we get out a tiny bit of enriched fuel. We get about 5% of the energy out, okay? The other 95% goes in this stockpile. This is nuclear waste. And we've got lots of it, right? But most of the energy is still there. We're okay with that because that 5% is still a lot. So we take that 5%, then we burn it in today's reactors. And those reactors are about 7% efficient. So they get 7% of the 5%. The whole end-to-end fuel cycle gets less than 1% of the energy out of uranium, right? Those reactors are not wildly efficient. But we still love it because it's carbon-free and it's still a lot of energy. So, you know, that shit's radioactive and scary. This is what these stockpiles look like. They go on 4 miles, right? We just collect this stuff. We have no idea what to do with it. So I already described this. This is my attempt at making a pie chart out of a can. So 0.7% is how much energy we get. So we designed a new type of nuclear reactor that's powered by nuclear waste. So in our reactor, what happens is, you know, well, this is describing neutron bombardment. So you actually have to enrich the fuel. That's what this looks like. So get rid of a couple of neutrons. Now we're to U-235. And then this is fission. Bam. And then those things go and enrich more uranium. The idea is that we would design a reactor like this. It works kind of like a candle or a cigar. It burns from one end to the other. A candle does this too. You know, when you light a candle, it has to turn the fuel from a solid to a liquid before it can actually burn it. So the leading wave enriches fuel in this reactor. The second wave burns the fuel. So we enrich fuel right inside our reactor. And it burns from one end to the other over the course of 60 years. That's pretty cool because it means we don't need those enrichment programs. It's also cool because it's a lot more efficient. We get more like 20% of the energy out instead of 0.7. Right? If you shut down those enrichment programs, you almost completely eliminate the risk of people stealing enriched fuel to go make bombs. Another big problem that today's reactors have. So back to my useless pie chart. Does it look like a pie chart or should I redo it? Wow, nobody wants to tell me what to do? Okay. So this is a stockpile in Kentucky. 700,000 metric tons of depleted uranium sitting on the surface of the earth, no plan, just gonna hang on to it in case what? Well, maybe in case we design a better reactor. We can take that crap, burn it in our reactor, and power the entire planet, including growth, for the next 1,000 years without even digging up any more uranium. That's how much energy is sitting right there. There's no alternative energy besides nuclear that comes anywhere close. You guys remember these guys? 99%? No? They were in the news a few years ago. And it's kind of interesting because these guys right here in Wall Street represent the 99% in America, and they're bitching about the top 1%. Can you guys find yourself on this chart? Turns out the top 99 in America is the top 14% globally, right? You guys already won the evolutionary lottery by becoming humans. That's pretty awesome. You're like the top dogs in the history of the world. Then you won the socioeconomic lottery of becoming Americans, which is pretty awesome because no matter how bad it gets for you, it doesn't really get as bad as it does for the people in the bottom of that chart, right? Top 14 is pretty good, even if you're at the bottom. I think that's pretty good. I feel pretty good now that I've seen this chart. So what I think it means for me and for you is that we could sit here and nitpick over trying to win a third lottery and become like, I mean, actually, I put in pictures of lottery winners because I thought you'd want to see this. These are some very attractive people. Look at this. These are the people who won the lottery. And I started reading stories about them on the internet yesterday. All of these people, all their friends, felt like they should have won the lottery too and started bitching at them to give them some money and pay off their credit cards and student loans, and now they don't have any friends anymore. There's a zillion sad stories of lottery winners out there. Anyway, that's kind of a side diversion. But the point being, look at this, 161 million British pounds. That's a lot of money. Anyway, I don't care if you win the lottery. What I think is, at this point, we already won enough lotteries. We need to take that advantage that we have. We live on the West Coast, things are awesome, we get Teslas and we get iPhones and we get all that stuff first because it's our responsibility to figure out how do we make this technology solve problems for the whole world, right? Not just you and me, right? Yeah. Okay. Oh, these are more sexy lottery winners. Okay. There's zillions of them. Okay, so this woman here is loading vaccines into a $2 styrofoam cooler, right? When she's going to truck them across the Sahara to a clinic, start injecting kids with vaccines, about 20 to 50% of them fail, right? Now, the way a vaccination campaign works, you need to get up pretty close to zero for it to matter, right? This is like practice because they fail so often, and hundreds of thousands of kids are dying every year because they've been injected with bad vaccines and they don't know it, and so they're not really vaccinated. So we took a look at this problem. Bill Gates asked us to work on solving this problem. So we invented this thing, which is kind of a thermos bottle, a super thermos, that you can put vaccines in. So this thing, you can stick it in the sunshine, in the Sahara, with no external power, come back 6 months later, and your vaccines will still be cold. So this is an example of a project we developed at the lab, and now we've shipped it. We have companies that manufacture and commercialize this thing for the developing world. And in time, we hope that we'll really have an effect because those styrofoam coolers I showed you are good for about 4 hours. This is a pipe organ, actually. But I'm showing you because it's actually an antenna, right? What happens is the pipe resonates at a given frequency. And you'd have different pipe for each frequency, each key on the keyboard. And so this gets kind of interesting because now we don't use pipe organs. We use a synthesizer. What's in there? Anybody want to guess what's in a synthesizer? Chips and a power supply. Yeah, good. Thank you. Somebody who's listening. All right, so we synthesize all of those frequencies. These are those domes you see on boats. Each of those contains a satellite dish that's physically steerable so that it can aim at a geostationary satellite to get internet to the boats. That dish on a predator drone, in the front of a predator drone, aims at satellites so that kids in Nevada can control the drone with a joystick. But what's interesting about this is that nobody has any idea how to do it better than a dish. So we invented this thing, which is a flat panel. It's manufactured like a circuit board. It's pretty cheap. But it can electronically steer a beam to aim at satellites, right? Now, that's not just cool for predator drones and getting Wi-Fi on your Alaska Airlines flight. It's cool because right now, we've been putting up satellites, LEO satellites. They're close to Earth and they're whizzing by, right? The only way to talk to them is with a steerable dish. But I can take that thing and duct tape it to your roof, and it'll find satellites and track them and talk to them. And every one of those new satellites has as much wireless communication capacity as the entire network did last year, right? Using this antenna, we can get gigabit wireless to everyone on the planet. I think that's gonna be awesome. This is based on a new technology called metamaterials. So these are materials that don't exist in nature, but that we can create, that give us new superpowers. So we're commercializing that stuff. I'm gonna skip this stuff because we're running out of time. This is how to curb global warming. Let me tell you about the cool project I've been working on lately. and how I was gonna show you how to stop hurricanes too. Anybody seen these 3D printers? I work on this one, it's called MakerBot, so it's a little, actually somebody here has one of the booths out there. You just draw something on a computer, click print, and it'll go make it for you. They're exciting and fun. Anyway, I've been imagining what could we do with 3D printers, new things to do with 3D printers. And one of the things I started doing is looking around saying, okay, well, where haven't computers gone yet? And I realized, you know, in every one of your businesses right now, we use computers to collect data, to analyze the data, to make better decisions, right? We don't have any data about anything you ever ate. I mean, Visa knows what restaurant you went to. But we don't know what you ate at all. And I imagine that someday that will change. Right after you get an electronic lock for your iPhone, you will start to think, maybe it would be nice if I could keep track of what I eat and correlate that to health effects. So I started imagining, what if that thing was printing my meals? What if I had three buttons on there? You know, what I ate yesterday, what Beyonce likes, and I'm feeling lucky. And you push one of those buttons, and the machine would have toner cartridges of frozen or dried and powdered food. A print head would put down a pixel of food, hydrate it with a needle, zap it with a laser to cook it, because lasers are cool, rinse and repeat for every pixel, and it prints you a meal that's customized for you, right? It avoids your allergens and dietary restrictions, maybe injects your pharmaceuticals. But it would know what it fed you, and it would know every day what it fed you, and it'd keep track of that over time. And then we could correlate that to health effects and start to figure out, well, you know, the last time I fed this burrito to somebody, born on the same day as you, same gender as you, smoked the same number of cigarettes as you, ate the same number of Big Macs as you, here's what happened to them when they started eating this food, right? That's the kind of data, that's what we're talking about when we say big data. We want data, I don't want to know like what you reported to your doctor once every 4 years. I want to know everything you eat. And I want to know that for 7 billion people, right? So we need to find ways to get the computers to know. But what's cool about ideas like this is that we also get a lot of efficiency gains. So when you think about how Americans eat right now, you and I, we drive to the grocery store, we fill up a cart, drive home, put it in the fridge, eventually cook some of it, throw packaging in the dumpster out back, you know, leftovers go in the fridge for a week before we throw them in the dumpster out back. Every American throws out 40% of their food before they ever even eat it. That's what we do. Every American grocery store throws out 2,000 pounds a week in expired food before we ever even sell it, right? We're not a very good role model. And the problem with that, I mean, that's cool because we're Americans and we can do whatever we want. But everybody else in the world, all those developing nations where the population growth is, well, they eat the same thing every day and very little meat. And if you give them an extra dollar before they buy an iPod, they spend it on more meat and more variety in their diet, right? The rest of the world, trying to eat like Americans. Americans, bad role model. You take that, combine it with population growth, something's got to give. We have to change things. We have to do something different. We cannot feed everybody the same way we have fed them. What's cool about the machine I describe is I generate no local waste. I go to the farm, I let a tomato ripen on the vine. It's so juicy and delicious and practically gonna fall apart in my hand when I pick it. Couldn't possibly stand a ride to the market. But I take that and I flash freeze it, powder it, stick it in a sealed toner cartridge with a barcode on it. The FedEx guy comes and puts it in my machine. Shelf stable for years, that tomato. And then the machine is gonna print a meal that's customized for me with that awesome tomato that I've always dreamed about. I always feel like I'm let down when I have tomatoes. I feel like I've never had a good tomato in my life. And it's gonna take 3D printers to solve it. Okay, I'm done making shit up for the day. I'm gonna get off stage. I'm gonna hang out for a while. Anybody, feel free to come and harass me and tell me why I'm full of crap. I'm okay with that. I won't bite your head off. And I love hearing about what you guys are up to. So please come tell me what cool projects you're working on. Or email me. That'll go to my spam datings. No. All right.